it was the worst of times. So begins the first chapter of Charles Dickens' novel, A Tale of Two Cities. The words, a series of opposites, are a fitting opening for this review, which is a tale of two Roslins, although there is only one. For the two books recently published on the subject are as opposite to each other as the phrases in Dickens' novel. There can be no arguing that Roslyn Chapel has long been revered by Freemasons, and since the publication of the Da Vinci Code, Roslyn has been brought to the attention of a new audience. The chapel has become so popular that the freedom visitors once had to peruse the chapel has now been reined in to guided hourly tours. However, the popularity of the chapel has not reined in authors or publishers hoping to cash in on the interest. The first book in our review is The Roslyn Hoax by Robert Cooper, the curator of the Grand Lodge of Scotland Museum and Library. Cooper is considered to be an expert on Scottish Freemasonry, and his position with the Grand Lodge certainly puts him in the right place to increase his body of knowledge. Hoax asks some interesting questions throughout the course of its 315 heavily footnoted pages. For example, Cooper asks if Freemasons have been the victims of a conspiracy. A nice switch from being the cause of one. He also asks whether or not the chapel has been altered over the years to make it Masonic, and if the famed Kirkwall scroll has been manipulated by those with agendas. But perhaps the biggest question is who would benefit from such a conspiracy. Now, while all of this may sound rather fanciful, Cooper has not written a conspiracy book. It is a book that is well-researched and pulls no punches in setting the record straight on the Sinclair family's involvement with Freemasonry, the truth about those skull and bones on the tombstones, and many other long-held myths about Roslyn, the Sinclair clan, and the continued existence of the Knights Templar. But not everyone is quite ready to abandon the idea of Roslyn being more than simply a collegiate chapel. In Roslyn Revealed, the writing team of Alan Butler and John Ritchie look at this enigmatic library and stone from a pooled body of research which spans a number of years. Ritchie actually grew up in the village of Roslyn, and Butler has written several works involving the chapel. The book is fairly routine for the genre, quoting and mentioning other speculative authors where it fits their own findings. However, the authors do introduce the person of Sir Gilbert Hay and his connection to the chapel, and the Roslyn light box, which is located in the east end of the chapel, and which the authors are convinced was designed to mark astrological happenings. Beyond this, Roslyn Revealed reveals little that is new. Roslyn's intricate carvings are connected to similar images, allowing the authors to interpret them as Kabbalistic, pagan, or connected to the sacred feminine. Perhaps at the end of the day, the two books could switch titles and be closer to representing the contents therein. And here are our publisher's picks. First up, My Dad is a Freemason by Richard Vang, published by Square Circle Press. This is a book that every Masonic lodge should have at least one copy of in its library. Vang has written an easy-to-comprehend assessment of Freemasonry, what it is, and what it stands for that every newly raised Master Mason should read with his children. The book is richly illustrated in full color and is a concept that is long overdue. Next, Symbolism of the Blue Degrees of Freemasonry by Arturo de Hoyos, published by the Scottish Rite Research Society. This book is not cheap. It'll cost you as much as a year's dues in many American lodges, but it is $50 that should be spent. De Hoyos has edited the complete text of Albert Pike's previously unpublished esoteric study of the craft, Lodge Symbolism. An addition to the book is the complete text of several old Masonic exposés. Next, we have Mozart the Freemason by Jacques Henri. This is published by Inner Traditions. Musicologist Jacques Henri presents an account of Mozart the Mason that is more a look at how Mozart patterned his music after Masonic ritual than simply another bio on a famous Mason. Henri argues that Freemasonry played as vital a role to Mozart's music as Lutheran Christianity did to Bach's. And finally, we have The Book of Fate by Brad Meltzer. Two things attracted me to this book: the square and compasses, and Brad Meltzer's name on the cover. Meltzer is a well-regarded comic writer and current scribe for the Justice League of America. However, the Masonic symbol on the cover is about as deep a connection to the craft as the book has to offer, and Meltzer's comic work is much better writing. All of these books are available online at thelodgeroom.com.